6. That is Terry McDonald Kedieu. Starting 14th on the grid from Doncaster Racing in a Ford Mustang car number 7, we have David Lacey. Starting 15th overall from Multimatic Motorsports in a Ford Mustang car number 0, that is the entry actually of Jason Priestley. Pardon me, we had some error there, but it was Jason Priestley starting in the 15th spot. On the pole position, we have Scott Maxwell. My apologies to Scott and Jason for that error. 16th overall, Fitzgerald Racing, car number 81, the entry of Mike Fitzgerald. 17th on the grid, the first racing entry, car number 22, that is the entry of Michael Culver. Starting 19th on the grid is the mostly motorsports entry, Pontiac Firebird, car number 79, that is driven by Chris Thompson. Moving down the grid to 20th on the grid from mostly motorsports, car number 78 is Michael DeFontes. Starting 21st from Strudwick Motorsports in car number 90, that is the entry of Rael Claude Vornichon. Starting 22nd overall from Ferrari of Houston in car number 85, that is Kevin Crowder. Starting 23rd on the grid in car number 51 is Paolo Dalsin driving the Honda Prelude. Starting 23rd on the grid in the Honda Prelude, of course, Paolo Dalsin. Starting 24th is the Hyundai Motorsports entry, the Hyundai Tiburon of car number 8, that is Gord Cullen. Starting 25th on the grid from Hyundai Motorsports is the Hyundai Tiburon of Didier Scrannon. Didier Scrannon racing in car number 6. 26th on the grid is the WTF engineering entry. It's an old Achieva, car number 48. That is from Mr. F. Del Vecchio. Starting off, 27th on the grid is the D&I performance entry, car number 49 of Jim Middleton. Starting 28th is car number 23 of Arlo Coda. And starting 29th on the grid, the Gen X Racing entry, the Mazda RX-7, car number 9, that is Alex Juhas. Starting 30th overall is the Ferrari of Houston entry, a Ferrari 348, car number 44 is Alex Rangos. Starting 31st on the grid, car number 92, is the Hyundai Elantra, car number 92 of Derek Luger. Starting a bit further back on the grid there, but still doing a good job of it, is the Power Racing team, car number 24, with Andrew S. Linder. Starting 33rd on the grid is the Metric Motorsports team, a Chevy Camaro, car number 10 of Peter Cohen. Starting 34th overall is the Phoenix American Motorsports entry, a Pontiac Firebird, car number 33 of Joseph Aquilante. Starting 36th overall is the DMA Racing entry, car number 59, that is the entry of Emil Asantalo. Starting 35th overall is the Mikau Motorsports team, a Chevy Camaro, car number 50, that is Mike McCalmont. Starting 36th is the DNA Racing team, a Ford Mustang of car number 59, that is Emil Asantalo. Starting 37th on the grid is the Kent Motorsports entry, a Pontiac Firebird, that car number is number 96, and the driver is Joe Kent. Starting in the 38th spot for Kent Motorsports is another Firebird, this time being driven by Jimmy Chamberlain. And our final qualifier from Thornley Racing, car number 98, Paul Kitchener. Alors Michel, une liste des inscrits, 39 voitures, 4 classes différentes, et on est sur le tour de réchauffement derrière le pace car, et ça sera pas long avant le départ.
Et attention au départ, justement, parce qu'avec un aussi grand nombre de voitures sur la grille, imaginez ce qui va se passer dans le premier virage s'il y en a qui roulent avec les épaules un peu larges.
Now, it'll be a rolling start, so there'll be some saving of metal there, but certainly the run into the first corner, the Senna corner, should be a wild one. And, of course, we are now on the first of two warm-up laps. The pace car should come in at the end of this lap, and then they'll do one more lap on their own, and then we'll be underway. But then again, these things are up to change. We will stand by from the word, and we do have a yellow flag being displayed at the main start-finish line, which indicates, of course, that the pace car is on the track. Alors, Michel, c'est vraiment une course que chaque année, c'est une des vedettes de le week-end. C'est la compétition endurance, mais cette fois-ci, une chose qu'on n'a pas, c'est un changement de pilote. Si on se souvient des enduro-séries dans le passé, il y avait toujours ce règle qu'il fallut. Ils ont fallu aux pilotes d'arrêter dans les puits pour faire un changement de pilote ou un arrêt au puits qui était obligatoire. Mais cette année, à cause des nouvelles règles dans le Motorola Cup, ce qu'ils font, c'est qu'il n'y a pas d'arrêt. Ça, c'est un sprint de 50 minutes au plancher tout voilà. le temps.
Exactement. Alors, quatre classes au programme. Grand sport, on peut reconnaître ces voitures. Ce ne sera pas facile à la vitesse qu'ils vont passer devant vous, là. Mais ils ont écrit en blanc, dans le bas du pare-brise, sur un fond rouge, StarTech. La classe sport, écrit en blanc, Radio Products, avec fond vert. Toujours écrit en blanc pour la classe tourisme, c'est Cellular sur un fond bleu. Et finalement, la classe compacte, écrit en bleu, le mot paging sur fond blanc.
Now, in terms of the celebrity quotient, I realize that many of you are here to see actor Jason Priestley make his Montreal racing debut. We are underway with the second of two warm-up laps. The yellow flag still being waved as the cars open up the pace a little bit. And they are underway, of course. The start should take place next time around, the yellow flag being waved at the main start-finish line. I want to just apologize again to the members of the Multimatic Motorsports team. There was a bit of confusion there regarding the qualifying order, but indeed, it is Scott Maxwell, our quickest qualifier, and Jason Priestley is racing. He is in the car number zero. He is starting 15th overall. So if you want to keep your eyes on Jason Priestley and his progress throughout this 50-minute race, keep your eyes on car number zero. Of course, for Quebec racing fans, a well-known name of Didier Scrannon racing in the Hyundai Tiburon, he is racing in car number six. Now, I'm not going to say the other drivers are not celebrities, but at least at this point, the two big names of the series have to be right now, Jason Priestley and Didier Scrannon. Of course, Didier Scrannon, well-known to Quebec racing fans as the voice of the Kart World Series and also doing Atlantic coverage on the RDS TV network. Alors, 39 voitures, c'est pas mal achalandé. C'est comme l'échangeur Telcot, 5h30. C'est le rush hour, absolument.
Ça ressemble un peu, vous souvenez-vous, de la série Honda?
Tout le monde, toujours, parce que la série Honda était où Didier Scrannon a fait ses débuts. Je pense que c'était 85 où il a fait ses débuts. Et Didier Scrannon et plusieurs pilotes ont commencé dans cette série. C'était le hécatombe presque chaque tour avec eux, mais il y avait toujours un gagnant de la course, alors ça allait bien à la fin. Mais quand même, je pense que ce course ici, c'est une expérience, et spécialement avec les conditions de piste, qu'il est froid, il n'y a pas de soleil. Je pense que la visibilité est un problème, mais quand même, c'est une chose que ce n'est pas évidemment les conditions idéales pour la course, mais quand même, il fait frais. Pour la mécanique, c'est bon, pour les freins, c'est bon. Et on va jeter un coup d'œil de le progrès. Et je pense que Scott Maxwell a fait un très bon travail parce que son chrono de qualif, 2 minutes 2.057, il a devancé le Firebird en deuxième place par presque une seconde. Alors ça, c'est pas minimal. Alors, just again, a reminder that the Scott Maxwell pull time of 202.057 is certainly almost a second quicker than second place on the grid right now. And as the cars now go into 2x2 formation, it should be a rolling start. Next time they come around, the main start-finish marshal is waving the yellow and green flags. He alone will make the decision, of course. Now they're coming down that casino straightaway. They still have the chicane and then the dash for the green flag.
Alors, le préposé au départ est prêt. Il veut s'assurer cependant que la formation est correcte.
Ladies and gentlemen, I know that most of the crowd is on their feet for this because this is going to be a wild one, folks, especially those of you at the center corner. Fasten your seatbelts, folks. Here it comes. Motorola Cup Racing. Will it go green? Will it go yellow? We'll find out in just a moment. As here they come. And they go green.
Nous avons un départ.
And they're off. And a three-way battle for the lead right away. Will Maxwell hang on to the first turn? He has the inside. Yes, Scott Maxwell maintains his lead. Three wide through the center turn. Three wide. And so far, they've all come through in one piece. Amazing, the first turn. Absolute traffic jam, chaos, but they're all through in one piece, and Scott Maxwell maintains his lead.
Alors, beaucoup de discipline dans ce première série de virages. On s'attendait au pire, aucun accrochage. Scott Maxwell qui tient le haut du pavé en ce début d'épreuve.
Now keep in mind, of course, our top 15 qualifiers were all in the Grand Sport category, but we have Sport cars 16th and 17th overall on the grid, plus a few more Grand Sport cars buried back in the field. So there will be a lot of stress for these guys getting through some slower traffic, especially on these first few laps. So folks, even though the first corner was clean, look for a lot of passing in every move, every possibility here, especially I think one of the key passing areas will be the lower hairpin of the circuit, the casino hairpin. Alors Michel, vraiment la première virage était c'est presque mon cœur a presque cessé de battre, mais mais la vie continue.
Ouais, ben fort heureusement, on n'a rien eu à déplorer. Et à certains moments, on était à trois côte à côte. C'est assez impressionnant.
Now, of course, this series is racing sprint races and endurance races. And in the case of a Terry McDonald Cadieux, perhaps, the female driver of car number 26, she has entered in both races today and tomorrow. So she, if she wins her category, for example, she will only score half points. It's just the way the system works to favor the sharing of cars. We already have one car heading for the pit lane. I didn't get a shot of it, but already one car having some trouble as Scott Maxwell crosses the line with a big gap over car number 17. And that was certainly a nice job there in terms of getting ahead and staying ahead. That's the TF Racing entry of Jeff Lapkovich. So Scott Maxwell certainly has a nice, healthy lead after one lap. And from my position here, I cannot see in the pits who had that problem. Once again, that car in front is the number 45 entry. And there we see a shot in the pit lane. That is a one of the Hondas. I'm trying to make out who that is and see what the problem is, but certainly not a great start for that driver. That's the Honda Prelude, car number 51, we believe, of Paolo Dalcin, already in the pits. There you see our leader, car number 45, the entry of Scott Maxwell. And we have a Mustang 1-2 right now with car number 17. That's the Jeff Lapkovich entry, taking up second place. Of course, the Lapkovich family has a long history here at Circuit Jules Villeneuve, racing in the Players GM Series 10 years ago and more. And Jeff certainly carrying on the family tradition for racing here. As there's another little Ferrari battle brewing a bit further back in the pack between a couple of our 348s. Of course, those are a couple of refugees from the defunct 348 division of the Ferrari Challenge. But once again, as they come around to complete another lap, a lot of battles and a lot of scrapping going on for every position here. As Scott Maxwell crosses the line, the gap now just over 2 seconds. So we have Scott Maxwell, then Jeff Lapkovich. Stephen Earle now in third place. Benoit Thiege, fourth, then followed by John Shirk, Peter Lockhart, Devin Powell, and John Heinrichsi. Jocelyn Hébert running in ninth place, and rounding out the top 10, that's John Kohler.
Alors Scott Maxwell, qui mène depuis le départ avec Jeff Lapsovich, qui est juste derrière. Stephen Earle est troisième. Benoit Thiege est quatrième.
Currently on our timing scoring sheets, we have Didier Scranton listed as 34th overall. And as he is racing in the compact category, that certainly places him, I think, in fourth place overall, or fifth place in the compact category. So certainly, I think a problem there on that first lap or second lap for Didier Scranton. Getting a replay now, heading into the center turn. What do we have here? Whoa, a very, very challenging move there. Jason Priestley in car number 0 took quite a shot there and was almost knocked into the gravel trap, but some very over-aggressive driving there. I think that was car number 56 who was involved in that, and that was certainly a real bonsai move. And we'll see if Priestley has to pit for that. And now we have a spin. That's car number 44. It's Alex Rangos having trouble there. Yeah, that's Alex Rangos, who is stuck on the circuit and is not moving. So he's got a Ferrari, but he's going nowhere right now.
Alors la Ferrari de Rangos qui est immobilisée à un endroit stratégique.
Actually, I think that was Joe Kent who was involved in that collision with Jason Priestley. So, Jason Priestley, welcome to Montreal. We don't always drive this way, but certainly that was a, I'd say, a rude maneuver by forcing his way in there. That was a real suicide attempt, and in a sense, he used the car of Jason Priestley to stay on the bloody road. So, I think Priestley is going to have a few comments for that driver when he gets back to the pit, back to the paddock. But right now, in the front, Scott Maxwell and Jeff Lapkovich getting a replay now of Alex Rangos on the giant screen as he loses the back end. And thankfully, the other Ferrari 348 missed him there, because that would have been a very expensive crunch for both drivers. But Scott Maxwell, after qualifying a full second ahead of the field, finds himself now with a pretty healthy lead, I think, of just over 2 seconds. That certainly will help him. It's always nice to be up in front, but of course, at the rate he's traveling, he'll be catching traffic in the next couple of laps, and that could also play a very important factor in this race as to whether or not Scott Maxwell can make it through traffic well.
Alors Scott Maxwell tente de se bâtir une avance un peu plus confortable, de se donner un coussin, parce que s'il sera pas tard, déjà il va rattraper les retardataires, les moins rapides, et à ce moment-là, dans la circulation un peu plus lourde, il faudra jouer du coude pour conserver sa position.
And as we've seen with Alex Rangos, mistakes do happen here, so, you know, nothing's in the bag yet for Scott Maxwell. Yes, he seems to have a big lead in that white, red and blue Mustang. Number 45, racing in the Grand Sports category, but certainly the second-place car of Jeff Lapkovich is staying close. And now a move on the inside as the Ferrari 348 goes side by side. Does he pull it off? And we have a Porsche and Ferrari going at it here with Benoit Thiege in the Porsche, and that Ferrari driver is Steven Earle. So Steve Earle and Benoit Thiege side by side down the straightaway. One of them will have to give here. Now here's a good test of acceleration as they're flat on the floor. Who'll pull ahead? And it's the Porsche. The Porsche, Benoit Thiege, a bit of late braking, kind of shuts the door there on Steve Earle. So Steve Earle is really, I guess, hot on the tail of the car he's following.
Benoit Thiege avait été impressionnant l'an dernier au volant de sa RX7 là avec sa Porsche 911. Mais une très 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 belle course jusqu'ici.
Yeah, Benoit Thiege, of course, is partnered with Richard Spinard, and if Richard can make it back from Detroit in time tomorrow, he'll be in the race. Otherwise, Benoit Thiege will race in both races. And there's a lot of action taking place here in the midfield as these categories kind of settle down, but certainly you got a lot of hungry drivers there from the Grand Sports category who are stuck behind cars from the Touring category or Sport category. And it's a very frustrating thing, because here on Circuit Gilles Villeneuve, yes, there are passing opportunities, but they are limited. And as this race is only 50 minutes long, getting a replay now of this, the action between the Porsche and Ferrari, a good little a duel of acceleration. And I think that Benoit Thiege just kept on the gas a bit longer, a bit of late braking. And Steve Earle had no choice but to tuck behind him and follow him the rest of the way.
Alors c'est donc au freinage que Benoit Thiege a réussi à devancer Stephen Earle.
Alex Rangos, after his spin, is back in action, but we have him currently listed as 30th overall. So Alex Rangos now up to 29th, but certainly in terms of the standings, it's Maxwell followed by Lapkovich, Thiege, Earle, Shirk, Powell, Lockhart, Kohler, Jocelyn Hébert, and then a bit of a gap back to the number 7 car. That is the entry of David Lacy. Keeping an eye again on that battle between the Porsche 911 and Benoit Thiege, and also further back, number 11 is certainly going at it there. That is the car of Devin Powell, that yellow Firebird with the hood scoops. And certainly for him, it's one of those situations where you have to really go for it. Once again, that battle we are keeping our eye on. There's another good battle there between the Acura NSX of Rael. And actually, I think I'm mistaking that for car number 77. No, that's car number 11 indeed, sir. That's the number 11 entry of Devin Powell. So it's Maxwell, Lapkovich, Thiege, Earl, and John Shirk, the top five. Of course, John Shirk has raced here for many years in Honda events and also in the Enduro series of the past. So a lot of these drivers do have past experience in the series, and that certainly helps them in terms of figuring out Circuit Gilles Villeneuve and knowing their braking points. As we continue to follow this battle between the Acura NSX car number 28. And that is the John Shirk entry. Of course, Rael is a bit further back in the pack. Those of you cheering on our dear friend, Mr. Vornichon. Currently, I don't have him on my scoring sheet. Yeah, he's coming around 19th right now. So after a decent qualifying performance from him, you will find that Rael has basically stayed in position where he started. Now, the battle for the lead in the Grand Sports category is still a two-horse race. And it does seem to me that Jeff Lapkovich is getting a bit closer. It is kind of hard to measure. We'll wait till they come past the line again and get the official time and scoring on it. But even visually, yes, you can see that Scott Maxwell is being gobbled up by Jeff Lapkovich. Now remember, this is still kind of early going in the race, and perhaps there was a mistake made by Maxwell there. And certainly as we head into the final turn of this lap, there is quite a bit of action taking place between those two leaders in the Grand Sports class that come across the line, wait for the gap. It's just over 1 second, okay, so things have really, really gotten tighter there now.
Justement, alors on réduit la marge beaucoup du côté de Jeff Lapkovich. Par contre, la Firebird jaune numéro 11 de Devin Powell a enfin réussi à devancer la LSX numéro 28, qui est celle de John Shirk.
Once again, getting a view here of some action heading into that final turn as we watch Benoit Thiege. And there is that passing maneuver as the bright yellow Firebird makes the move on the Acura NSX. And certainly, I think for a lot of people watching this on the giant screens or hearing my voice around the circuit, you think of an Acura NSX, you say, hey, no problem beating a Firebird, right? Wrong, because John Shirk there is definitely using his knowledge of Circuit Gilles Villeneuve to full advantage and giving himself a chance to move up into the standings and perhaps onto the podium. And Scott Maxwell, a little bit ragged through the corners there. Of course, they're riding the curbs throughout this race. But I think that Jeff Lapkovich can now really smell the victory here as he is closing in inexorably. Scott Maxwell, visor open. Nice shot there on the giant screen. You can see right into his eyes. And for this crowd here that has stayed behind, it's great to see so many of you staying this late in the evening to watch this Motorola Cup race. Remember, we'll have one more for you tomorrow with some different drivers. As for Jason Priestley, he is now listed 11th overall. So Jason Priestley, after a start that saw him starting off in the 15th spot, he is moving up. But of course, he did take quite a hit from one of the cars there, one of the Firebirds that really, I think, kind of ruined his chances to move up and join the battle for the lead here in the Grand Sports category. A quick reminder again, there's Grand Sports, Sports, Touring, and Compact. Four categories battling it out here in this, the first ever appearance of the Motorola Cup in Montreal. Making their way down through that final chicane before the start-finish line. And now, as I mentioned, I think there is some traffic playing into the role. Yes, indeed, as they head into traffic. That's car number 92. That is going to be their next challenge. That is the Derek Luger entry. Derek Luger in car number 92. Now, will he move over, or will he perhaps do Jeff Lapkovich a favor, do some blocking? We'll find out in just a moment. Of course, the Luger racing in the compact category. And no, he pulls aside. Yes, nicely done. Did not so really inconvenience anybody, but I think that, yeah, Jeff lost a bit of time there. He was a little bit tentative going around that car. Of course, you have to be. And there you see that Scott Maxwell is putting on his brights, warning the cars ahead of him. Yeah, the leaders are on you. And of course, as the lighting conditions here are pretty dim, he wants to make sure that the guys ahead of him know, okay, a leader's coming through, give me some room. Let's see if they respect that or whether it's just power on past him. Yeah, there's no problem there as he goes past the Miata. And certainly We'll wait to see now as they come to the lower hairpin of the circuit, the casino hairpin, closing in on car number 9. That is the Alex Juhasz entry in the sport category. So again, it's Maxwell Lapkovic, Thiege in third place, Stephen Earle fourth, followed by Powell, Shirk, Lockhart, Kohler, Hebert, David Lacy running 10th now, Jason Priestley in 11th. And in terms of that battle, we are going to try and get that on the giant screens for you as soon as possible. But right now, our kind of focus now is Jeff Lapkovic is much closer now to Scott Maxwell going through traffic. But again, he still has a lead of just over a second. And as they come around to finish this lap, we'll get their latest tail of the tape. They cross the line. Yeah, it's still a bit of a lead for Maxwell there, so he's not really under intense pressure yet, but certainly it's kind of like a seesaw battle. It's yo-yoing back and forth between the two drivers, and it's really anyone's race. And I do mean that because it's just one mistake away from either driver taking a very commanding lead. Of course, Scott Maxwell is very experienced, having raced in endurance and street stock racing for years, and is also well known for his appearances in previous Enduro series here in Montreal. But this, of course, is his first time being here with his three-car team. Of course, he's teamed up with Jason Priestley and also Greg Wilkins. So, and it seems to be a pretty well-funded effort also, with some Ford support that helps out, definitely. Helps pay the bills. And now we're just getting a shot now of Jason Priestley, and we do see that he is in his own little battle there, but not really making much ground up on the drivers ahead of him. Now, if we can get a shot there of the other side of the vehicle, of course, he took quite a hit on the driver's side of the car early on in the race, but it seems to be okay. Of course, we'll get a shot of it now as he comes around the hairpin in car number zero. Now, that's actually our battle for the lead. And yes, we had a bit of a back marker playing a role there. Yeah, I think Scott Maxwell got lucky there.
Absolument. Scott Maxwell a réussi à doubler ses retardataires, sauf que son rival, Jeff Lapkovic, a été pris, lui, dans la circulation.
Yeah, and I think Jeff Lapkovic is realizing that the second step of the podium could be his home for this one, because just in the space of one lap there, he lost a big chunk of time as they come down to that final chicane before the start-finish line. You can see for yourselves, folks, that as Scott Maxwell crosses the line in car number 45, he is definitely pulling away a bit more now from his pursuer in second place.
Et qui se rapproche maintenant? Benoit Thiege.
Yeah, Benoit Thiege also has the hammer down. And I think that Jeff Lapkovic, rather than looking over his shoulder and wondering who's behind him, he's got to worry about both directions now. He's got pressure behind and pressure in front of him. But then again, these are the top three in the Grand Sports category. Jason Priestley still listed 11th overall. I did want to see Jason on the podium this year because apparently he's gone blonde a la Jacques Villeneuve with his hair. It would have been interesting to see, but it's going to take a real challenge and a real battle from Priestley to make it from 11th up until 3rd. And of course, in terms of those top 11 cars, those are all Grand Sport category cars. So he definitely has quite a battle ahead if he has any hopes of finishing on the podium. But of course, for Priestley, his first ever appearance here, and with no knowledge of the local track. And whoa, a close call there as he almost ran from behind. That was a bit of a close call there as those two, that's what, Camaro and a Firebird, are battling it out there. That's car number 69. That was definitely about to push the other guy off the track. That's the Stu Jones Racing Firebird. And Stu Jones certainly a bit anxious to get ahead in that little battle. Stuart Jones, he's just ahead of the Brian Fodd car. That's on car number 10. Actually, car number 10, we have it listed as the Peter Cohen entry with Bertrand Godin. So we'll keep our eye on that one too. Of course, Peter Cohen is scheduled to race today, and Bertrand Godin is scheduled for the race for tomorrow. Getting a view of that now. Yeah, that's Peter Cohen. And now the car has gone through. So there you see it side by side. No, he fights right back. So Peter Cohen, of course, one of the aces of the Players GM Series, certainly showing that he's not aged at all. Now as they make their way around the circuit, you see that little tap in the rear that almost puts Cohen into a spin.
Alors, la voiture numéro 39, la Firebird de John Heinrichi, a dû abandonner. Problème avec le sélecteur de vitesse.
Well, that's some pretty bad news for one of the top drivers in the Grand Sports class, John Heinerse. Driving that 95 Firebird has dropped out of the race with mechanical problems. So Heinerse, who is running fifth in the championship, will not score many points here. But then again, he may score a few. Of course, points are awarded to most of the top finishers, and he does have a chance to score a few points. But obviously, he will slide down the rankings.
Because alors là, c'est, excusez, c'est Benoît Tige qui est en train de servir la médecine que Lapsevich servait précédemment à Scott Maxwell. Il est presque dans son coffre arrière. Et par cela, Maxwell, lui, peut se sauver.
Yeah, Maxwell's doing a great job in the front, really controlling the race nicely. And now we see that one of the Ferrari 348s, that's the 99 car, is making some moves of his own. And we'll see how far he can go. That is the Steve Earle entry. Steve Earle, of course, is also racing in the Ferrari Challenge race on Sunday here. And Steve Earle, an orthopedic surgeon, is a very talented driver now. But as he looks in his rearview mirror, that car number 11 certainly looking pretty big. And now the big battle down the straightaway. What's quicker, a Ferrari 348 or a Firebird? It's pretty close, but I think that Earl has the inside and will not lose the position. That's right. You see the Firebird tuck right back in, but now back on the power again, and a big power slide there from car number 11. That's the John Kohler. That is the entry of Peter Lockhart, pardon me.
Et surveillez bien Benoît Thiege, au freinage.
And Benoît Thiege, yes, he's definitely a motivated man as he powers through, and he has taken away the second place from Jeff Lapkevich. How about that? But Jeff isn't done yet. He's going to fight back into the corner.
Superbe bagarre.
Sorry. My thanks to Gilles Boursier from La Presse for that correction, as Devin Powell is indeed driving car number 11 there. I apologize for that.
Et Stephen Hurl a réussi à reprendre. Conserve l'intérieur. La lutte est engagée très, très, très sérieusement.
Now, I know that Devin Powell knows the price of a Ferrari 348. And I'm sure that will affect his decisions here, but it's one of those things that you just can't ram the guy from behind. You want to pass cleanly. Now a problem for car number 78. That is the 78 car. That is Michael DeFontes, who's gone off. Michael DeFontes, part of a Californian team here in town, and obviously some problem. We'll know more about that later, but for now, we're kind of watching as Scott Maxwell continues to lead. This is the battle of the race, and now we see that Devin Powell making a move on the inside, and for the upcoming turn, he's in the right spot, because as they head for the hairpin and this tight right left complex here, yeah, he's got him, and Earl's backed off. So is it a problem, was it a misshift? We don't know, but Stephen Earle has let Devin Powell move ahead, and it's still Scott Maxwell, Benoît Thiege now in second place, Jeff Lapkevich in third.
Devin Powell, donc, au volant de sa Firebird, a réussi à reprendre sa position. Et maintenant, il va tenter de creuser l'écart.
Well,
on va revoir le tout.
Yeah, here's the replay coming up.
Il se présente très bien pour le virage qui est un droit, donc, à l'intérieur. Et c'est ainsi qu'il peut prendre avantage de sa position.
Yeah, and I think under braking there was the problem for Steve Earle. You saw that the car really got a little bit skittish as he had to downshift and brake there. So Steve Earle now, as we watch him, he's kind of maintaining his contact with Powell, but he is being caught up by Peter Lockhart, who is just following behind that battle. So certainly the Grand Sports class giving us plenty of battles here. There are several battles further back in the field, too. In terms of the Jason Priest, the update still linked as 11th. Getting a replay now on the giant screens of the pass of Benoît Thiege on the Jeff Lapkevich Mustang. Very clean, no problems at all. But then again, coming through that little chicane, Lapkevich came pretty close.
Devin Powell est installé au quatrième rang.
And I tell you one thing, you know, when you see a Firebird or Camaro going around the circuit, they've been doing it for years, the GM Challenge and all the Enduro series we've seen here through the years, and something about this track that the Camaros and Firebirds always go well here, even though we do have a Mustang in the lead. Now, of course, the battle between Vige and Lapkovich has really played well to the hands of Scott Maxwell, because now the gap that he has really stretched out, and it's really a question of car control. As for our good friend Didier Scrainin, our timing and scoring now has him listed as 33rd overall, and is certainly running, I think, in fourth place or fifth place in the compact category. So it might be a bit of a struggle for Didier to get back onto the podium for the compact podium ceremony. But of course, Didier Scrainin will be racing Sunday morning here in the Canadian Formula Ford Championship, and will have another chance for success there. But for now, Didier is buried back in the standings along with Derek Luger, and that's the battle for 34th and 33rd place. So certainly off the pace, but then again, it's hard to keep up to these guys in Grand Sports, as once again the giant screen show you a nice shot there of Scott Maxwell as he powers his way around the circuit.
Il vient d'ailleurs de doubler une Tiburon, la voiture numéro 8.
Yeah, ça c'est l'autre équipe de Hyundai.
C'est Jeff Larrabin ou Gordon Cullen.
Je pense que c'est Gordon Cullen. Well, Scott Maxwell, it's a nice Sunday drive on a Friday evening for him, as he made a good start and survived the early attack of Jeff Lapkovich. And now, as we see his car power along the outer edge of the island, we look back in the field to see where Benoit Thiege is. And yeah, he's a bit of a ways back there. So I think that if Scott Maxwell doesn't make any more mistakes, he has the win pretty much locked up as we're into the final half of the race.
Hey, Devin Powell est sur le point de jouer un vilain tour à Jeff Lapkovich.
Now, of course, we are focusing on the battle in the Grand Sports category, and for good reason, because these are the guys on the track who are in the lead. Jason Priestley update, where is he now? Still stuck in 11th spot. And of course, in this series, the cars may have to carry ballast so that they fit the minimum required weight. And certainly it evens up the field between different models, and it also makes it tougher to pass. So it's one of those things that, especially on a circuit like this with these high speed straightaways, hard braking, it's very, very tough to make up ground, especially in a short race. You know, 15 minutes, 5-0 rather than 1-5 is very, very tough. And we do wish Jason Priestley luck in his battle for the podium. But for now, we can see that Steve Earle now is under more pressure, and I'll just make out who it is from here, but certainly Steve Earle is slipping back even more into the clutches, and I think that is Peter Lockhart who's closing in behind him. No, actually that's car number 17 of Jeff Lapkovich that has certainly slipped back. So a bit of a change in the running order there. So it's Maxwell, Thiege, Powell, Earle, and Lapkovich, who was running in a pretty strong second place, finds himself now buried down in fifth place. So certainly a big, big turnaround there as he slid down the order. And Jeff Lapkovich, who looked like a certainty for the podium early on, that must have been something we missed here from the control tower, because that's kind of hard to explain a shift to position like that. But anyway, your leader is still Scott Maxwell. Benoit Thiege in the Porsche 911 is second. Devin Powell on bright yellow number 11, running third. Fourth overall, the Ferrari 348 of Stephen Earle. And fifth overall is Jeff Lapkovich. And Peter Lockhart is definitely picking up pace as this race goes on. Perhaps he saved his brakes, who knows? But in this Grand Sports category, we're getting quite a good battle here for the lead, with now, we think, just under 15 minutes remaining in the race. That is not confirmed, though, from time and scoring. Okay, so now we do have confirmation. 15 minutes to go in the race, folks. So those of you who want to catch a 7 o'clock movie, you'll make it. Watching Steve Earle working the wheel of that Ferrari 348, and there is no yellow paint on him. So even though it was very close there with Devin Powell, There was no contact, or at least no contact that resulted in a transfer of paint from car to car. But as we watch this race wind down now, certainly the story of the race. There's several of them, but I think Benoit Thiege is one of them, as he's made a real strong drive and certainly used all his experience to good use. And I think that also that Jason Priestley will have a few comments for several drivers who, especially that one incident that happened at the Senna turn, where he was essentially rammed off the road and certainly lost positions there. Once again, for those of you in the stands, please stick around. We will have complete coverage of the podium ceremonies in all four categories for you at the completion of this race. And for now, we watch with interest as another battle develops here. That is the John Shirk car, the Acura NSX. Pardon me, that's closing in on Jeff Lapkevich. Lapkevich has some kind of problem, it's obvious. I mean, there's something wrong with that car, or he is just perhaps nursing it for the race tomorrow, but we will see. But then again, it could just be the case of John Shirk putting the pressure on here in the closing stages, of course. This is still the early going of the championship, but every point counts. And as they head off to the next race, it's always good to move ahead of the competition. Getting a shot of it now on the giant screens. That is Jeff Lapkevich in that bright red Mustang, followed by the black Acura NSX of John Shirk. Just behind John Shirk is Justin Hébert, David Lacy running ninth, and now Jason Priestley has moved up to 10th overall, Greg Wilkins down on 11th, so those two teammates at Multimatic are running 10th and 11th overall, and Jason Priestley cracks the top 10 for the first time today.
Alors voilà qui est fait. Jeff Lapkevich a dû céder sa position. John Shirk au volant de l'Acura NSX. Et maintenant en avant.
And Didier Scraton moves up to 32nd overall. So Didier is putting on a late challenge too. He'll just need another 3 hours of racing to do it. And now we have a bit of a move happening here. Is John Shirk going for it? They're almost side by side. Yes. And he has the line for the turn, and he's done. So Jeff Lapkevich, we'll find out in the newspapers tomorrow what happened to him. But certainly he's fading away as John Shirk now moves ahead and takes over fifth place.
On va revoir justement ce dépassement à l'épingle Est. C'est au freinage, donc. Et Shirk maintenant qui veut creuser l'écart un peu.
Actually, that's the battle for sixth place. My apologies to Peter Lockhart, who's running fifth now. So it's Maxwell, Thiege, Powell, Earl, Lockhart, Shirk, and Lapkevich, the top six. And I wonder if Jocelyn Hébert will be the next driver to give Jeff Lapkevich a lesson in passing. For those of you who are compiling a lap chart, I have to give you my most sincere congratulations. That's absolutely amazing if you can do it with all these different categories and all the action going on. As we get a nice shot there into the cockpit of the number 28 car. And certainly a nice performance there by John Shirk in that Acura NSX. By my estimate, we do have just around 10 more minutes to go in this race.
Et on vient de retrouver notre meneur, Scott Maxwell.
Yeah, picking up Scott Maxwell on the giant screens as he powers past some of the other category cars. Of course, the different designations on the windshield let you know who's who. And it's definitely Scott Maxwell's day in the sun, even though there is no sun. And certainly a nice performance by him. He hasn't put a wheel wrong the entire race. He led from the start. And it's been wheel to wheel, wire to wire for everybody else. But of course, we wonder now about the battles further back in the field and exactly how far can Jeff Lapkevich slide. He was running second. He is now listed in sixth place. But he has been passed by John Shirk. So he's indeed in seventh place overall. I tell you, considering the action here, we've had very, very few incidents of any kind. So certainly these drivers showing a great maturity here at Circuit Jules Villeneuve, committing very few errors.
Benoît Thiege, qui est dans sa Porsche 911, est en deuxième position. Par contre, Scott Maxwell semble très à l'aise et s'est battu une avance relativement confortable.
And keep in mind that Benoît Thiege started seventh in this race, so he's made quite a comeback here, and he did not get a great start. He was really boxed in by traffic early on. So if you have to decide a star of the race, I think that if it's not going to be Scott Maxwell, you'd have to give it to Benoît Thiege. Devin Powell really chucking that yellow Firebird from side to side through that quick right-left chicane. We see Steve Earle closing in on one of the touring category cars. And he should pass him with no serious problems. Yes, indeed, Steve Earle comes through. Dr. Stephen Earle, he's an orthopedic surgeon. And one of the guys racing on Sunday, rather, in the Ferrari Challenge. Once again, it's Scott Maxwell, Benoît Thiege running second, Devin Powell third, Stephen Earle now fourth, Peter Lockhart fifth, Jeff Lapkevich slipping listed sixth, but in my visual confirmation could tell you that he slipped back even further than that. It's John Shirk who's taking number six spot, followed by Lapkevich, then there's Jocelyn Hébert, David Lacy, and Jason Priestley still in the top 10. Priestley driving that Mustang number zero, with his Multimatic teammate, Greg Wilkins, right behind him. So Jason Priestley doing pretty good there in terms of the inter-team battle, not being outraced by his teammate. And we'll wait to see, yes, and now he goes roosting past one of the Hyundai entries. And Jason Priestley, I think, is pretty comfortable in that 10th spot. I don't think his teammate can take him as they head through the center turn. Michel, quelle course avec plein de rebondissements, mais je pense que l'homme le plus heureux, c'est Scott Maxwell, qui dans ses dernières minutes de la course.
Ah bah oui,
il n'y a pas de pression.
C'est ça, exactement. Il est seul de son groupe. C'est sûr qu'au début, Scott Maxwell a eu pas mal de problèmes avec Peter Lakchevich, parce que, il le serrait de près, il mettait la pression et tout ça, mais... ça s'est réglé assez rapidement.
Once again, Scott Maxwell in the lead now. And this has been one of those races where the pressure has not really been there. As this thing winds down, usually as these races come to a close, there's a late challenge. And I think that Benoît Thiege must be thrilled to be in second place. And also, in terms of the gap between Thiege and Maxwell, at 11 seconds, it'll take a pretty big mistake for Maxwell for Thiege to have a chance here. There's really no chance for Thiege unless Maxwell really throws it all away. And with Scott Maxwell's experience, I don't think they're going to do that. So Benoît will certainly be happy to be on the second spot on the podium. As the blue flag is being shown to several cars, of course, that's one of the battles that goes on between different classes. And Steve Earle, and that Ferrari being hassled by a Hyundai. How about that for a battle? And of course, as the acceleration continues, but that was interesting going through the center turn, how that Hyundai driver, that was the number eight entry, was kind of like door to door with the Ferrari and holding its own. It was only when the horsepower had to come on and the acceleration that the Hyundai fell away, but certainly, door to door racing into the center turn, very nice. Car number 94 on the giant screens right now. That is the Peter Lockhart car. And great Sunoco sponsorship. And he's all over the curbs. Currently listed fifth overall. On our timing and scoring sheets, Jason Priestley update. Jason Priestley update, 10th overall. Of course, Jason Priestley got his first taste of racing by racing in the Toyota Celebrity event in Long Beach, and like many other Hollywood stars, he has caught the racing bug and will be appearing at the Motorola Cup races throughout North America So if you're planning on doing some traveling this summer and want to coincide your travels with some more racing, you'll have a chance to see him in action much more often. And I do think that as Jason Priestley progresses, you will see him move up to perhaps not more serious forms of racing, but perhaps more expensive and more demanding forms of racing, and perhaps even open wheel racing, perhaps stuff like the 24 hours of Le Mans. I know he's been to Daytona and Sebring, but certainly Jason Priestley, he can act and he can drive, because he is holding off his teammate Greg Wilkins and doing it nicely too. We have a bit of a traffic jam developing on the main straightaway as several cars tuck into line for that final right-left chicane before the start-finish line. And incredibly, everybody is keeping it together. That's car number 89 in that Camaro. Car number 7 in the Camaro. And there we see Alex Rangos, who had a spin earlier on. Alex Rangos, one of the other Ferrari Challenge drivers. He finds his way through the traffic also. Okay, we have an update here that car number 96, the driver is out of the car. He's having a brake problem. Brake problem for car number 96. There you have it, folks. So that is bad, bad news indeed. Car number 96, that is the Joe Kent entry. He was running a bit further back. He was, on our last look, running back in around 9th place, 10th place. Actually, 16th, rather. Pardon me. Yeah, Jason Priestley running 10th. Special thanks to Gilles Boursier, our guest ghost announcer here, who's been whispering in my ear the whole race long and making me look good. I owe you one, Gilles. Thank you. And there you see it, the visual confirmation that with no brakes, you ain't going nowhere at Circuit Gilles Villeneuve. So apparently we have around 5 minutes to go in the race, 5 more minutes. And Scott Maxwell, who has led from the start, is certainly looking good here. Getting the 5 minute board being displayed here at the start finish line. And of course, as the laps tick down, it'll be replaced by the white flag for one lap to go. And the checkered flag that awaits car number 45 of Scott Maxwell. Of course, this driver comes from Unionville, Ontario. And he's part of that three car Multimatic team along with Greg Wilkins and Jason Priestley. As for the Jeff Lapkovich update, we still have running 7th on our Italian scoring sheets, having fallen away from that battle with John Shirk. And Jocelyn Hébert is closing in slightly. It's still a bit of a gap, but anything can happen in these final few minutes here. And we do see that the checkered flag is being prepared by the start-finish marshal. We have not seen it waved yet, but of course that is one of the next steps to this race, the checkered flag. And of course, stick around, folks, for the podium ceremony. The champagne will be flying, especially for Scott Maxwell, if he can hang it together and keep his car on the road.
Scott Maxwell, donc, il va se présenter au fil d'arrivée. Un dernier virage, et ce sera fait. Scott Maxwell qui a failli l'échapper là, justement devant le Bienvenue Québec.
And here it comes, it's the final lap. Here it is, the checkered flag for Scott Maxwell. Scott Maxwell scores victory here at Circuit Gilles Villeneuve.
Eh bien, il a ramené de fil en fil.
And Benoit Thige hangs on to second place. So a great drive from Benoit Thige from 7th on the grid to 2nd overall in the Grand Sports category.
place, on va retrouver Devin Powell.
Yeah, Devin Powell just went past our broadcast location to take third, so we have our podium in Grand Sports. And Scott Maxwell pumps his fist through that mesh window and waves to the crowd. Well-deserved victory for Scott Maxwell, and he'll be heading for the podium, which is just a few moments away, in the company of Benoit Thige and Devin Powell. Of course, we have a few other podium ceremonies to go along with the Grand Sports, so folks, stick around. Won't be long now before we have it all for you. And certainly an exciting race.
Ce podium.
Yeah, it's going to be in a very crowded podium as the checkered flag flies for the last few competitors. As they come around, of course, all these cars will head back to the pit lane and the paddock. And of course, these guys are back in action tomorrow. In some cases, it'll be the same driver, but in some cases, there'll be some fresh faces. And there you see the happy waved hand of Scott Maxwell. And it's a big cheer from the crowd. That's it, folks. Scott Maxwell, a great victory here at Circuit Gilles Villeneuve. The first ever race of the Motorola Cup at Circuit Gilles Villeneuve has gone to Scott Maxwell.
Il a fort bien résisté aux assauts là, en début de course de Jeff Lapkowicz. Et par la suite, il a su creuser l'écart. Et dans le fond, le grand perdant dans tout cela, c'est Lapkowicz, qui était deuxième et qui n'a pu tenir le coup sous les assauts de Benoit Thige, ensuite de Devin Powell, Stephen Earl. Allez-y, nommez-les. Alors donc, pour Lapkowicz, c'est un peu dommage, mais c'est une septième position.
So once again, recapping the final positions here. The Grand Sport category accounts for our top 14 drivers. The top non-Grand Sport driver is in the Sport category. And I think that is Fitzgerald. We're going to check with the time and scoring, but I think that Fitzgerald has come through. Mike Fitzgerald in car number 81 in the Sport category. I think he is our Sport category winner. And second place in the Sports category, I will get confirmation on this, but I do believe it is car number 22 of Michael Culver. So from our time and score, I can tell you that, of course, in the Grand Sport category, it's Maxwell, Thige, and Devin Powell. In the Sport category, we're calling it Fitzgerald, followed by Culver. And in third place, we think it's Alex Juhas. We, of course, we will wait for final confirmation of those positions. In the touring category, our fastest driver, Paolo Dalcin. And he has been followed by Paul Kitchener and Andrew Linder. Of course, this is all to be confirmed by timing and scoring, but that's our initial indication. In the compact category, of course, where Didier Scrannon was racing, we think Gord Cullen has the win, followed by Frank Delveco, and in third place overall, I think Scrannon made the podium. So Didier Scrannon might just have made the podium there, but of course that is unofficial information. We wait for the final word and of course the podium ceremonies. Alors Michel, je pense que si Didier Scrannon peut être sur le podium, il sera très très heureux après une course très difficile pour lui, mais je pense que l'histoire de la journée est évidemment Scott Maxwell avec une victoire dominante.
Ah, tout à fait, oui. Ça a été une superbe victoire. De toute façon...